Okay, so welcome everyone. Our speaker today is Albert Cabot, and he will tell us about his PhD work, his progresses in his PhD work. So, thank you.
Okay, so hello everyone, and I hope you are doing okay. And well, I hope you hear me okay too. So yeah, this is a bit, I'm approaching a bit the end of my PhD, so this is a bit a talk in which I will present some of the results of my PhD in more broad sense. And I've been doing it in a close collaboration with Gianluca and Roberta. And well, I will be talking about synchronization and coalescence in dissipative quantum systems. And basically, the very broad idea behind this is that of quantum synchronization, is that of whether it's possible to observe some synchronization phenomena in quantum systems. And this is a topic in which there has been quite a lot of activity in the last 10 years. And many of the works can be divided in two approaches, which is the first approach is to study some of the typical systems of quantum optics of nowadays, which are coupled two-level systems, coupled spins and harmonic oscillators, and to try to analyze whether there is a collective phenomenon there that we can identify as a form of synchronization. And then there is this, and well, we have been working mainly in this approach these years. And then there is also this other approach, which is taking one of these classical systems in which there is synchronization as the van der Waals oscillator, and try to write the quantum version of it, which is something which is not very easy sometimes, and try to study what happens with the synchronization phenomena there. And okay, we have been addressing this lately, but the talk will be mainly on this. And if I have a bit of time afterwards, I will say a couple of words about this, but I don't know. And eventually I will explain it. In any case, eventually I will explain this in another case. So this is the approach we have been working with, which is studying systems of coupled dissipative spins and coupled dissipative harmonic oscillators, and studying the collective phenomena there, to see if there is something, if there is some synchronization phenomena emerging. And let me, with this slide, introduce a bit some context of the systems that are being, some of the systems that are being studied nowadays in quantum optics. And well, quantum optics is a very vast field, but here I will talk about some examples that I believe are quite illustrative for this context. So basically, in the last years, what has happened in quantum optics is that there has emerged a lot of new platforms, a lot of new ways of making two-level systems and few-level systems, and people is also working intensely in scaling up these systems, in making them more complex, in trying to couple them. And basically, in the case of two-level system and few-level systems, maybe in the 90s, the system, by the paradigmatic system were trapped ions, and now people is working with new stuff like superconducting qubits, which has been particularly successful for experiments in quantum computation, and also other kinds of qubits like color centers in diamonds and other stuff. And basically, another important trend it has been that of trying of interfacing these spins and few-level systems with photonic nanostructures. And the goal behind this is to try to control the optical properties of this system, to try to control how this system emits light or absorb light, and also to try to couple these different systems through the light modes of these nanostructures. And these are some examples of this. And for instance, this is a recent review in which they comment on advances of embedding quantum dots in photonic crystals. And I like this example because this is, let's say, a new way of making the James Cameron Hamiltonian, which was something used to describe trapped ion experiment. So now here we have the quantum dot, which is the plays the role of the trapped ion, and the photonic crystal cavity, which plays the role of what was maybe a Fabry-Perot cavity. And also there are these recent experiments that I think are very illustrative for our context, for the context of this talk. And are three experiments in which the physical idea behind the experiments is the same, but they do it with different kinds of few level systems. So with this, I want to realize that people now is working with many kinds of systems. So basically the idea of these three experiments is that they have two qubits and they couple them through a common optical field, and they are able to observe subradiant and subradiant emission. So in the most recent one, they do it with atoms. So they trap two atoms using optical tweezers near a photonic nanocavity, and they couple them through the light in this cavity, and they are able to make them to emit in a superradiant way or in a subradiant way, which are collective phenomena. And this has been recently realized with atoms here, but I mentioned other platforms, as for instance, these qubits in photonic structures made of diamond. So basically they observe the same physics, but in a completely different system. And even before that, almost 6 years ago, they did the same with this other kind of qubits, which are the superconducting qubits, and with microwave cavities. So basically they are doing this cavity and waveguide quantum electrodynamics physics with many stuff nowadays. And then there are, I also wanted to comment this completely new quantum system, which are the optomechanical oscillators, which is something that people brought this system into the quantum regime maybe 10 years ago with this experiment. And these are nanostructures in which there is a localized optical mode, but this mode is coupled. Besides this mode, there is also a mechanical mode. So both modes are coupled in this same structure. And by a technique very similar to that used with trapped ions, they were able to cool to the ground state the excitations of this mechanical mode. So they were, these people was able to bring a nanomechanical oscillator to the ground state, basically. This is what they did in the experiment. And this was in 2011. And shortly after, there were many people in other groups making the same, and furthermore measuring and preparing some non-classical states for the mechanical mode. So this optomechanical oscillators is a new way of making basically quantum harmonic oscillators. And this is something very recent. And again, people in the field is working to scale up the system, to try to make arrays of this system. So this is a bit the context. I wanted to summarize a bit, because in this in this talk I mainly work with quantum systems made of coupled dissipative units, so made of coupled dissipative qubits and coupled dissipative harmonic oscillators. And I want to analyze basically if there is any collective phenomena there which is a form of synchronization, basically. And this is what I will show in this first section. I will talk in a very broad sense about how is the dynamics in these systems and how we can see the emergence of a spontaneous monochromatic oscillator, oscillation there. And then I will try to illustrate these more general ideas with a simple model. And then I will, after that, I will present how these results also emerge in more complex scenarios. In this first section, let me introduce a bit the dynamics of these systems, of many of these systems, in a very, very broad sense. So the dynamical system usually is made of some coupled units, in our case, coupled qubits or harmonic oscillators, and these units are dissipative. And in the cases of interest for us, this admits a reduced description, which means that the dynamics of the system is at the end, you can write it as a matrix equation. So you have your relevant degrees of freedom, which might be some qubit or some harmonic oscillators, and there's a matrix coupling them, and you might have some driving terms or some of these non-homogeneous terms. So a way to understand this kind of dynamical systems is basically to diagonalize the matrix and to study the eigenmodes and eigenvalues of the system. Or maybe in a more physical language, the collective excitations of these dynamics. So we start from a coupled system and we decompose the dynamics in these uncoupled collective excitations. And these collective excitations are characterized by having a frequency, having a lifetime or a decay rate as the system is dissipative, and having an eigenmode profile. And for instance, if we take this collective excitation, the eigenmode profile tells me that maybe it's more important for this unit than for this other. So at the end, we take these coupled dynamics and we decompose it in these terms. And these enable us to understand different properties of the system. So by analyzing these excitations, we can understand why for instance, in the dynamics of the collision of a system of harmonic oscillators, why there is this oscillation dominating dynamics. Or when studying the absorption or emission spectrum of the system, why there are this number of peaks, why they have this frequency or this width. Or when probing our system with a laser or a driving, why the system reacts to this frequency or to the other. So in general, we can understand many properties, many dynamical properties of the system, just looking at the collective excitations. So the question now is, if we have a system generally described by this kind of equation, can we find some collective phenomena, some synchronization collective phenomena? And the answer is yes. And what we can find the spontaneous emergence of a monochromatic oscillation between the units of a system. And I will basically, in this section, I will basically explain two mechanisms by which we can find the emergence of this kind of oscillation. So these are two examples of this synchronous evolution that we can find in the systems. And this is a simple example that I will explain in more detail later. And this is the case of two coupled dissipative qubits. And I'm showing the dynamics of the X component of these spins. So basically what we see is that at the beginning, there is a superposition of various frequencies. The dynamics of the system is made of various frequencies, but after a while, they oscillate only at one frequency and the phase between the two oscillations is locked. And we call usually this transient synchronization because usually what happens is that the stationary state of the system is non-oscillatory. So this here the decay is very small, but this oscillation ends up dying out. And this is not the only possible case, and in some cases, the steady state of the system admits the presence of non-decaying oscillations. So is a red line and a blue dashed line. And this happens, for instance, in a system of two coupled harmonic oscillators. And what we observe is that there is a transient similar to this, but then the system settles into this oscillation and never decays. So I will explain now two mechanisms that enable these kind of oscillations to emerge in these systems. And I will explain them through the picture of the collective excitations of the system. So the first mechanism is the presence of a long-lived collective excitation. As I said, the dynamics is made of, well, it's a superposition of the dynamics of these collective excitations. Each one has its frequency, its decay rate, and it might happen that one of them is long-lived with respect to the other. And this means that one of them has a decay rate that is much smaller than the others. And this means that after some time, the dynamics of the system will be dominated by this long-lived oscillation. And there will be just one frequency, and for instance, the spins will oscillate at this frequency as we have seen. So this is an example of these dynamics. So we start, we again have the two spins, and the dynamics of the edge component can be decomposed in these collective excitations in a set of AM modes, set of frequencies and decay rates. And at the beginning, all of them are important for both. So we see a mixture of frequencies and somewhat a bit irregular oscillation. But after a while, as there is one which is long-lived with respect to the other, after a while, only this collective excitation contributes significantly. And we see that the dynamics of the two spins is given by just this slowly decaying oscillation. And this explains why we observe this clean monochromatic oscillation. And if this decay rate is non-zero, at the end it will die, and we have transient synchronization. But we can also have cases in which the decay rate is zero, and we see the oscillation in principle as the steady state of the system. And this case is also interesting, as usually this kind of state is very non-classical, and the units of the system are strongly correlated. And this was explored, for instance, many years ago by Gonzalo Manzano and many people in the audience. Okay, so this is the first mechanism. And the second mechanism is coalescence, which now I will explain a bit more in detail what is coalescence. But the second mechanism is that it can happen that the collective excitations all have the same frequency. So this is what I show in this diagram. In this system of the two spins I mentioned, there are up to four collective excitations during the dynamics of the system. And I will explain later why this is the case. But the important thing is the frequencies of these collective excitations. And here I'm varying the difference in the intrinsic frequency of sigma x1 and sigma x2. And what we see is this kind of bifurcations. So at the beginning, for the tuning smaller than this value, all collective excitations have the same frequency. And as we increase the tuning, there is this subsequent bifurcation. So it is in this regime in which we can also observe a form of synchronization. And basically, this translates into this kind of expression for your dynamical quantities like sigma x. You will see that they are still made of a superposition of collective excitations, but there is just one frequency there. And then when you observe the trajectories, you are a bit surprised because, okay, yeah, there is just one frequency, but the phase is non-log at the beginning, the phase between the spins. But eventually, and I will explain why later, eventually they oscillate also with the same frequency and with a definite log phase between them. And we call this synchronization. And in this case, we see that this is decaying, so it's transient. But also for coalescence, there are special cases, and I will show one in which this oscillation is non-decaying. Okay, so this is related to coalescence, but I will explain a bit more in detail what is this. And these bifurcation points are exceptional points, which now I will explain what is this. So I gave a talk maybe almost a year ago about this kind of stuff. And I like to explain it in the following way. And I like this phenomenon of coalescence and exceptional points because because this is a qualitative, this represents a qualitative change in the dynamics of the system because of dissipation. So you put dissipation, and sometimes when you have dissipative system, this means that your collective excitations now have a finite lifetime and decay. But sometimes, as is in the case of coalescence and exceptional points, there is a qualitative change in the dynamics, and I will show it now. And I like to explain it through this example because more or less this is how I learned about this. So this is an optomechanical system, one of these I mentioned at the beginning. And basically it's a system in which you have two coupled units, an optical mode and a mechanical mode. This is the mechanical mode, this is the optical one, and it is a dissipative system. And the mechanical one has this frequency, and the optical one has this effective frequency, which you can make of the order of this one, because this is the beating between a detuned laser and the frequency of the cavity. And they are coupled. And basically, if you just consider the Hamiltonian, which describes the coherent part of your energy, you will see that in this case, in which the two modes are degenerate, as soon as you increase the coupling, there is a splitting in the energies of the collective excitation of the system. And you can think that when you put mechanical dissipation and optical dissipation, you might think that this collective excitation just acquired a lifetime because of these decay rates. And it's sometimes the case, but not here. Here, what you see is that dissipation changes also a lot the frequencies of your system. So basically, the blue lines are the collective excitations of your dynamical system. And you see that at the beginning, when you modify the coupling strength, when you increase the coupling strength, instead of seeing this immediate splitting of the energies, you see that there is a region in which it does not change, up to this bifurcation in which it starts to change. And these are the two decay rates which show exactly the opposite behavior. So this is another example of what I shown before with the speech. And this is an exceptional point. So let me show this in more detail. So this kind of system can be modeled by these Langevin equations for the optical degree of freedom and for the mechanical one. And this is the kind of system that you can describe with a matrix equation, as I said in the beginning. And the important thing for this analysis is the non-Hermitian matrix. So as this is a dissipative system, the quantum system is described by a non-Hermitian matrix. And in the diagonal terms, we have the frequencies and the decay rates of the two units and how they are coupled. And remember that we are in this special case. So what we do is to diagonalize the matrix and analyze the collective energies, the frequencies of the collective excitations and the decay rate. And basically, when there is coalescence and sectional points, you usually observe something, an expression of this type, which is something constant plus a square root. But in the square root, there is the subtraction of two terms, two positive terms, sorry. And you can see here that for a small coupling strength, this square root contributes with a real term, and you are basically changing the decay rates of the system. But up to the above the threshold, it gives an imaginary term, and you basically are changing the frequencies of the system. So this is a bit, this explains this kind of bifurcation phenomena, and is what you observe in systems in which there are exceptional points. So what happens just at the critical point where this is zero? So when the square root vanishes, you only have one eigenvalue, but this is not a normal degeneracy point, because you don't not only have one eigenvalue, but the two eigenvectors at this point become the same. So you just have one eigenvector. The two eigenvectors coalesce at this point. And this is why this is called an exceptional point and not just a degeneracy. And this is a bit a mathematical paper elaborating a bit on this. So a first consequence of this is that just at this point, the matrix describing your system is not diagonalizable. And in the preview, in the previous talk, I basically analyzed a bit the dynamics at this point. But okay. And here in this talk, we will focus on the fact that when you have exceptional points, these are in between regimes in which the number of frequencies change. So you these are in between these kind of regimes. So here we only have one frequency and here you have two of them. And this is interesting for us because of the emergence of synchronization, as I said. But there is much more beyond this. So there is much more physics that emerge because of this coalescence. And here I just want to mention a bit the trends, the effects that are being studied related to these exceptional points. So as I said in a previous talk, I analyzed how are the dynamics just at this point, and you can see that the system approaches the equilibrium state instead of in an exponential way, in an exponential plus polynomial correction. So this anomalous decay is something that is studied also in these works. Then there are this kind of chiral dynamics, which means that you can make loops in parameter space and your system acquires phases, and maybe I can get it here. So in my previously had these two parameters, the coupling strength and one of the frequencies. So imagine you start here and you start with one eigenstate, the minus eigenstate. So it happens that if you do a loop around the sectional point, if you change the coupling and the frequency such that you do this trajectory, when you end up in the same place of the parameter space, your state has changed. So it has acquired a phase, or you have moved from one eigenstate to the other. This kind of stuff happens. And this is being explored recently, both in quantum mechanical systems and in photonics. And both theoretically and experimentally, these kind of things are being observed. There is also people studying how can we use this to have a device which reacts, which is more sensible to perturbations, because if you are close to one of these points and there is a perturbation inside your square root, your system, your energy is split in this way, in this non-linear way, instead of in this linear way, so this might be useful. And then, of course, in systems in which there is gain and dissipation, this exceptional point is in between two regimes with different symmetry and different parity line symmetry. And these are some works exploring the physical consequences of this. And in particular, I have to highlight two works about this coalescence. I highlight these two references, which are brief introductions and reviews of the recent work, especially in the community of photonics and quantum mechanics, about physical consequences of this coalescence of eigenvectors. So a bit in summary about this section is that in the systems that we consider, we can understand the dynamics in terms of collective excitations. And I've identified two mechanisms by which a collective excitation, a collective monochromatic excitation, spontaneously emerge in these systems. And one is to have a long-lived collective excitation, then, as we have seen, there is this oscillation emerging, and the other is related to coalescence or exceptional points, and to have a regime, a parameter regime in your system, in which the relevant collective excitations have the same frequencies. Okay, so this is a bit the physical ideas in a broad sense. of this talk. And let me illustrate them with a simple model in which we can see in more detail how these dynamics emerge. Okay, so this simple model is a generic model of two qubits with collective dissipation, and it's a bit closely related to this experiment, these three experiments I mentioned in the beginning, in which they coupled two qubits through light, and they were able to observe these collective effects as subradiance and subradiance. So this is a bit the generic model, the basic model which can account for this physics. And so basically, in the system, it consists of two qubits, which are two-level systems, in which you have the ground and excited states, and we have two different frequencies. There are two energy separation between them. And because of some mechanism, as like it can be this common mode, these qubits interact in a coherent way. So this is the Hamiltonian of our system. And then we also consider dissipation, and we have this collective dissipation, which means that if this was light, a spontaneous emission would be correlated between the two qubits. The two qubits emit in a correlated way. And this is described by a master equation. So a master equation is an equation for the state of a system that is able to describe non-unitary dynamics. So with a Schrodinger equation, we describe unitary dynamics. Master equation is one of the ways you can describe dissipation. And we have the Hamiltonian evolution given by these interactions. And then this is a term of collective dissipation. We describe how these two qubits emit in a correlated way. And here I also, so this is the system we will study, and I also wanted to write this harmonic oscillator analog, which is maybe an analogy in a very broad sense of what these different terms mean. So the two qubits would be two harmonic oscillators. Well, qubits are not harmonic oscillators, of course, but we will have two harmonic oscillators with different spin constant, and this would be the different frequency. And this coherent interaction, it would be like coupling them with another spring. And then the dissipative collective interaction, it would be like having a friction force that is dependent on how the whole system moves, and not only on how one of the harmonic oscillators moves. So there is some situations in which this mode has more friction than this mode. And this is described by this kind of terms. And this is an example of this. So here, depending on the collective behavior of the two spins and not just on each of them. So this is the basic model that we consider here. And let me now illustrate how it is. So despite we just have two qubits, you hear me all okay?
Yes.
So to determine the state of the system, despite we have just two qubits, the state of the system is a 4x4 matrix. So it's already quite complex. And okay, we have
in different colors. Yes. No, no sé, tendría que darte un papel, pero me lo pongo aquí. Es que se me ha olvidado que empezaba a las 12.
¿Y ahora tienes que
mirar? No, bueno, ahora sí, bueno, lo miro así en el móvil. Es que se me ha olvidado hasta ahora, tenía que haberlo seguido.
Bueno. So even though we have just two qubits, you see that the state is already quite big. And as I said, the dynamics of this state is given by a master equation. This is an operator equation, but for our analysis, we can write it in a more convenient form, in this form. So we can write this state as a 16-dimensional vector, and the dynamics is given by this matrix, which is called the Newmillian. And this is a 16x16 matrix. So you see that even with two qubits, we have a 16 by 16 matrix running the dynamics. So it is already quite complex. But fortunately, there is some symmetry, and this is complex. This is not a general matrix, but it is a block diagonal matrix, and this has been worked in detail in this work by Marco. So what does it mean that it is a block diagonal matrix? It means that your large dynamical system is made of smaller and independent dynamical systems. And this is a huge simplification. For instance, if you study the populations of the density matrix and these red elements, to study the dynamics of these red elements, you only need to consider a 6x6 matrix instead of the 16. And the dynamics of these red elements is independent of the dynamics of the green elements. So this is a huge simplification. And in particular, the different blocks rule different quantities of the system. So this is also a huge simplification. Because if you are interested to study sigma, the set components of the spin, you will need to study this block. And if you want to study another component, the X or the Y, you will need to study this block. So instead of having to deal with 16 collective excitations, you maybe only need to deal with four of them, which is quite a simplification. So here, instead of writing down the matrices, so these are matrices, instead of writing down them, I try to draw this scheme for the system. Maybe it's more helpful. And let me comment on the blocks. So this red block is the largest one, in which there are six elements of the state of the system. And for instance, here the links mean a bidirectional coupling, and the arrows mean that there is a non-directional coupling. And for instance, this block, as they detail in this paper, it's in charge of the stationary state of the system and of the Z component, for instance. So if you want to know the stationary properties of the system, you study this block. And in this particular case, it's quite simple, this, because you see that this is the most excited state of the system. So if we put something here, it decays to this level, but it doesn't come back. And then it eventually decays here. So it is clear that this is the stationary state of the system, the ground state. But there are cases which is more complicated. And okay, and later we have these two blocks, the green and the blue, which are 4x4 blocks. This is just the complex conjugate of this. And basically this is made of diagonal elements of the density matrices. This is made of coherences. And in particular, if it is in this dynamical sectors in which we observe this synchronization behavior. So as I showed you previously, the monochromatic oscillation emerged in the X component of the spin, but it also does on the Y component. And this, to understand this quantity, you just need to understand this block and its complex conjugate. And this is why previously I shown that there were four collective excitations for sigma x. And this is also in charge of this time of this kind of two-time correlations, which are related to the power spectrum of the system. They give information on how the system absorbs energy or emits energy. And then we have these small blocks, which are not very relevant for us. So we will focus on this. We'll focus on this because basically synchronization phenomena emerge in this kind of quantities. Okay, so the as the other one is just the complex conjugate, we only need to analyze this. And as I said, these drawings I made, they correspond to a matrix, to a general matrix. And also here I define the central frequency and the tuning. And okay, now we will study now the eigenmodes and eigenvalues of this matrix in different situations. So basically I show an example in which there is coalescence, and an example in which there isn't, but there is one of these long-lived excitations. So basically what I show here is the case in which the coherent interaction is zero, but there is still a dissipative interaction, and the case in which there is a strong coherent interaction. And in the first panels, I show the frequencies of the DM modes. In the second, I show the decay rates. And I show them as I vary the detuning, which is the difference between the intrinsic frequencies of the two qubits. And in the case in which there is coalescence, I also want to show you the scalar product of the vectors that coalesce to show you how at the bifurcation point they become the same. So here the number of eigen vectors that you have just at this point, it is less than the dimension of your matrix, because some of the eigen vectors become just the others. So basically for us, the relevant thing is that we have this regime in which basically the four frequencies are the same. So here there are four frequencies that have the same value, and above this threshold we have basically two different frequencies, but four excitations. And here there are the decay rates. So the four eigen modes have different decay rates. And here, this point here that I show is a point in which the collective excitation has indeed is good in this system for zero detuning and zero coherent coupling, but dissipative coupling. You observe that one of the collective excitations is non-decaying, and you will observe this synchronous oscillation lasting forever. And then we have the other case in which we have coherent coupling, and here there is a splitting from the beginning of the frequencies, and if we analyze the decay rate, we observe that there are four decay rates, but there is one which is always quite smaller than the rest. And for zero detuning, it's again zero. So it's a case of stationary synchronization. And this kind of mode, this mode can lead to the emergence of synchronization, as I explained before. So let's see how synchronization emerges. So basically, in this part, I show an example of the emergence of this monochromatic oscillation due to coalescence, and in this part due to the long-lived excitation. And as I anticipated before, it is a bit surprising that this, okay, there is just one frequency, but you see that the relative phase between the edge component of the spins moves in time until arriving here, in which it blocks. And this can be understood recalling the theoretical result, and also the energies and decay rates of the collective excitations. So the general expression for this x component of the spins is a superposition of these four eigen modes, of the amplitude of the eigen modes, the decay rate, and an oscillatory term that in which there is a phase that depends on the spin and on the collective excitation, and the same frequency for all. So the oscillation has the same frequency from the beginning, but the relative importance of the phases of each eigen mode change in time because of this decay factor. So after a while, there is usually one of these collective excitations which decays a bit slower than the rest. And you see that here that the dynamics is dominated basically by this one that I call the 4-1. So that such that the phase relationship between the oscillation of 2 and 1 is fixed. Up to this point, it is fixed. But at the beginning, it moves because of the different phases and the different waiting time of the phases. So this is what we observe when there is this synchronization due to coalescence. And as I mentioned, there is some cases in which this last decay rate is even zero, and we would see this oscillator basically non-decaying. Okay, and then there is the other example for these monochromatic oscillations due to a long-lived excitation. And what we see is at the beginning there is a mixture of frequencies, but after a while there is just one frequency that matters. And again, this can be understood looking at the theoretical expression. At the beginning we have a superposition of different frequencies, but after a while, due to the differences in the decay rates, only one collective excitation dominates and you observe this behavior. And again, here this is decaying, it's difficult to appreciate because the decay rate is low, but it's decaying. But you can observe it also in a stationary. Okay, so this is we look at the trajectories and we observe this monochromatic oscillation, but we can also look at other kind of quantities, and usually in the kind of experiments I mentioned, people usually look at the absorption and emission spectrum of these systems. And these quantities, this type of quantities, are defined as two-time correlations. Here we consider the two-time correlation of this operator. And you look at the Fourier transform, basically. And in both cases of synchronization I've shown, you usually observe the combination of various Lorentzians, various peaks, with a different width, which, and this is a signature of super and subradiant emission in the systems. So coalescence is characterized by the fact that sometimes an interference effect can emerge because you have many excitations with the same frequency, so they can combine and interfere between them. This is the case here. We have a broad resonance, and on top of it, there is interference with a more narrow resonance. While in the case of long-lived excitation, you usually observe a set of peaks, and you can observe directly the different width of the peaks. So the fast decaying modes have broad peaks, and the long-lived excitations have narrow peaks. And in other contexts, this is taken as a signature of super and subradiant behavior, a connection with what's further explored here. So I still got the minute, I think. So I will explain how these physics emerge in more complex scenarios, and I will show it with three examples, basically, and then I will present the summary and the conclusions. So the first example of how this phenomena emerge in more complex scenarios is a kind of mesoscopic generalization of the previous model. So instead of having just two qubits in this work, they have two clouds of atoms. They have two clouds of atoms. You can regard them as qubits because you are only interested in one transition. And they have these blue atoms, these red atoms, they have different frequencies, omega 1 and omega 2. And they are coupled through a cavity mode, which induces collective dissipation. And they are interested in how the system emits light, in the properties of the emitted light through the system. So as they want the system not to decay to the ground state, they put repumping them, which is this one, and which pumps energy into the system, basically. And they study the properties of the emitted light. And they describe how, looking at the properties of the emitted light, they find a synchronization phenomena in the system. So despite the system has two frequencies, there is a region parameter space in which the system emits at just one frequency. And this is what they show here. They vary the difference in frequency between the two clouds, and they analyze the frequency of the emitted light with respect to this central frequency. So they basically find this region in which there is just one frequency, and they speak about synchronization. And okay, above this threshold, there is this positive branch. There is also a negative one, so you have two frequencies. And they analyze how this threshold moves when you increase the interaction or the size of the system. So, and when you analyze the dynamical system, what you basically see is that this is a region, this transition point is basically an excitational point, and this is a region of synchronization due to coalescence. So they have observed the same kind of physics in this mesoscopic generalization of the system. And then the two examples I want to mention are a bit, I want to illustrate the idea that this phenomenon, the phenomenon of coalescence and synchronization due to the long-lived excitation, it is not very dependent on the specific interaction. So for instance, collective dissipation is not something crucial. What matters is to combine a set of incoherent and coherent processes. So depending on how do you combine them, this kind of effects might emerge. And this is an example of a system without collective dissipation, in which we have a 1D array of quantum harmonic oscillators, all of them with the same frequency, coupled coherently, but we have the A's and the B's. And the A's dissipate strongly, and the B's not so much. So the system is described by this Hamiltonian plus the local dissipation. And basically, in this work, we were interested in the amplitude dynamics of the system. And the amplitude dynamics also give information of how the system responds to driving or on the power spectrum of the system. So basically, here I show an example for a system of six of these oscillators, but some of the results are general for larger systems. And basically what we observe is these are the, in blue, the frequencies of the collective excitations, and in red, the decay rates, and this is the coupling strength. So basically, we see the threshold behavior I've been commenting, and at each of these points, there is an exceptional point. And there is always a region, a finite region, no matter the size of the system, in which they all oscillate, all the collective excitations have the same frequency. So without dissipation, we would expect that the lambda introduced immediately in splitting, but because of dissipation, there is always this finite region in which there is just one frequency. And okay, and in this work, we analyze it a bit, the consequences of this when you probe the system. So for instance, in this region, despite you have many oscillations at this frequency, when you probe it, you find some interference effect because there is many stuff happening there, and you find the same interference effect in the power spectrum. But what I want, but the message of this slide is that we have very different interactions, but we also observe this coalescence behavior. And finally, I want to end with this. This is a system in which there is no coalescence, but there is a synchronization due to these long-lived excitations. And not only the case I mentioned of just one long-lived excitation, but there is also what we call band synchronization. And I will explain briefly now what is this. So the system is a 1D array of qubits. So we have alternating frequencies as before, omega 1, omega 2, omega 1, omega 2. And the decay rate also alternates. So there is local dissipation instead of collective one. And there is gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 1, gamma 2. And they are coupled with this kind of interaction. And we wanted to know if this kind of system can display this synchronous dynamics in the X component of the spins. And this is a bit what we analyze here. We basically vary these two parameters, the coupling strength and the detuning, and we find two regions in parameter space in which there is some synchronization behavior. And basically, region one is what I've been exploring, what I've been explaining, that it emerged a single collective excitation that synchronizes the system. And region two is a bit the novelty, and this is what we called band synchronization. Because in this region, no matter how large is the system, you have that the collective excitations group basically into two bands, very close bands. And this is what I show here. You can look, this is the spectrum of the system, the absorption spectrum. And here there are four collective excitations, but we basically observe two peaks. And this is the same if you increase the size of the system, you would observe basically two peaks. And what does this mean? This means that in each of these peaks, there are many modes with almost the same frequency. But because of dissipation, you are not able to resolve the small frequency difference in these modes. And basically what happens is that when we run in the tuning, that is the example, the could be in yellow is a small detuning, the could be in blue is detuning, and in red is a large detuning. What it happens is that the modes of one of these bands become long-lived, all of them. And there is a sort of effective two-body behavior, and your system synchronizes because of this whole band of modes. And you are not able to resolve the very small difference of frequency between the modes. So it's basically the same physics, but with a bunch of almost degenerate modes. And I think with this, I can conclude. And basically, what I shown in this talk is I explained that we can explain in a very broad sense how the dynamics in many of these quantum optical systems, and that you can understand them in terms of collective excitations. And I explained two mechanisms by which spontaneous collective monochromatic oscillation can emerge. These two mechanisms is a long-lived excitation, and the second mechanism is coalescence, which is the fact to have all the same frequencies. Coalescence, as I said, is an example of a qualitative change induced by the interplay of coherent and coherent effect and dissipation, and leads to bifurcations in the frequencies of the system, or to even more strange things as these chiral dynamics. And finally, I also shown that these synchronous trajectories are related to interference effects and super and subradiant effects in the absorption and emission spectrum of the system. And okay, I think that with this I can finish.
Okay, so thank you very much, Albert. Well, we have some, as usual, some or comments or questions, if there is some comment. Maybe I can start with some very basic thinking. Is there something like the degree of collectivity of the collective excitations? I mean, when you introduce the collective excitations of the array, can you make a difference of some excitation being more collective than others?
Yes. I think there are even people has proposed some measure to quantify the degree of collectiveness. And I think this is related on, let's say, how well delocalized is the excitation. So intuitively, if the collective excitation is very localized to one of the units, you would say that it's less collective than if it's evenly spaced in all the system. So yes, I believe there are some rigorous measures to quantify this.
And this may be also important for the dynamical behavior of the system, having very collective excitations, I mean.
Yes, of course, because basically, if this long-lived excitation is very collective in the sense that is very delocalized in the system, many units of this system will synchronize. Instead, if it was only important for just one unit, you would really, you maybe could not talk about a collective monochromatic oscillation. So it is important.
Okay.
Ask Christian?
Yes.
I don't know what is the subradiance and superradiance. Can you explain briefly define what is this and the relationship with the spectrum, with the spectra you have shown?
Yes, sure. So for instance, in the superradiance and subradiance are collective effects related to the, in the case of light, to the emission of light, and they emerge in coupled systems, for instance, in clouds of atoms, or even in these systems of two qubits. And it is an effect that, because of the interaction in the system, there are modes that emit a lot of light and modes that emit very little. I don't know. And the relation with this is that basically superradiance means that you're the width of these peaks is basically the decay rate of a spontaneous emission, to say it like that. So the broader the peak, the more the faster and the more light in general the collective mode emits. So when you look at the spectrum, when you look at the absorption or emission spectrum, from the width of the peaks, you can say which eigen mode or which collective excitations radiate more radiate more and faster, and which do it in a slower way. So for instance, we would say here that there is a collective excitation which is very broad. This means that it has a large decay rate, and in the spontaneous emission, there is a fast decay of the excitation in this mode. Instead, this very thin peak means that the excitation is trapped in this collective mode, and you need a lot of time. It needs a lot of time to radiate its energy to the environment.
Albert, there is a question. I have a question, but there is another question in the chat.
Sorry. I'm not sure
it's down there in the chat, but it is from Martinez. I don't know if it's Maria or
I think Rodrigo, maybe if somebody
is can... Rodrigo, how do you get zero decay rate?
How do I get zero decay rate? So basically how do I get zero decay rate? So this means that because of the interaction, there is a perfect interference. So there is a state which is perfectly decoupled from this environment. And it means that if you were able to put some excitation there, it wouldn't decay to the environment. I don't know if I answer in this way to you.
Albert, I have a very basic question. Might be stupid, but it is in comparison with the classical systems.
Yes.
About the role of nonlinearity and dissipation. Yes. I mean, in what you've explained, dissipation is an essential thing, while your models are linear. But if I go to the Kuramoto model for a classical synchronization, what it is essential, it is that it is a nonlinear model,
yes,
and there is no dissipation because it can be understood as a Hamiltonian conservative system. So I'm confused. My prototype model of synchronization in the classical domain is nonlinear, no dissipation. What you are showing us is linear dynamics, dissipation essential.
Yes. I mean, this is a crucial difference of what I shown here and what is some of the paradigmatic systems in the classical case. So and maybe this is more related to what I say, that there are two approaches. So in this first approach, the idea is to take these systems of coupled qubits and harmonic oscillators whose dynamics can be written in this linear way, and to see if there is this monochromatic oscillation emerging. But of course, the mechanism here, it is very different from the classical one. And in the other approach, what you basically take is one of these classical systems and try to see if you are able to quantize it. And in that case, it is more similar to the classical synchronization. But again, for instance, the example that has been in this other approach, the example of a classical system that has been quantized is the Van der Pol oscillator, in which there is nonlinear dissipation indeed. So yes, I admit that in this approach there is a huge difference, because the systems that you have are very different, and synchronization emerges because of different mechanism.
Maxi, just a comment. I do not understand why you say that the Kuramoto is non-dissipative. The system in which I have seen you can do an approximation and then you derive the Kuramoto model are self-sustained oscillators dynamics that arise in non-linear and dissipative system. So the example that Bert said about the Van der Pol is a typical example.
But if I remember correctly, the Kuramoto model can be mapped into a Hamiltonian system.
But it's not necessary. In some
surface of constant whatever, and then it is, I don't know.
Okay.
But what I'm just saying is that here, what seems essential is dissipation, it is linear dynamics. And in my prototype classical system, what it is essential is non-linearity. And I think that also dissipation is not essential there. So it looks to me to very different type of phenomena in the classical and the quantum domain. I don't know, I'm just trying to ask.
No. Yes, you are right in which in this case they have to be Yes. I mean, in this approach, they have a very different origin, and it's because the question behind this approach is take these systems, take these coupled spin systems, take these coupled harmonic oscillator systems, which are described by that linear equation, and see if something similar can emerge, and then. There is other approaches more focused in trying to quantize these paradigmatic classical cases. But this has also its difficulties and other stuff. But again, the successful in this other approach, the successful example, it has been a dissipative system also in that case, which is the Van der Pol oscillator. So in the quantum case, for the moment, dissipation is
always there. Okay. Yeah, comment something. I think that the point, I don't know much of this non dis. I've always thought on the Kuramoto model as a dissipative system, but we can talk on this later. Yeah. But I guess I think that the question is that not that the systems, quantum and classical systems, are different. The fact is that in in classical systems, people were interested in some types of synchronization. And now here, because in some representation, quantum dynamics is linear, then they don't have this freedom. And then they look for other types of synchronization and they found this thing. But in fact, this type of this coalescent synchronization can, if I understood properly, can also happen in classical systems. That's the point where two eigenvalues coincide by this mechanism, you will have for classical system the same mechanism of synchronization that you have here for quantum. Is that that this mechanism was not very exploited in the classical case, but I think it's also present there. Do you agree, Albert?
Well, up to some extent, the example of the clouds of atoms, up to some extent, it can be understood as a classical system. And yes, these mechanisms I explained are not exclusive of quantum systems. They rather they are general mechanisms of that can emerge in this linear kind of dynamics. So yes, this is what we find in this kind of quantum systems, but the general mechanism is you can also find it in a classical system. I agree with that.
If I can say a comment, this is very noisy. The Kuramoto model classically, it should be always thought as oscillations on a limit cycle in the regime in which you have forgotten about fluctuations in the amplitude. And these will usually, limit cycles always arise in dissipative systems. So it is true that there is no linearity, but dissipation is important to have that sort of description as a limit cycle oscillator. Whether in the Kuramoto model itself, this is not present because there has been already the elimination of the amplitude, doesn't mean that if you go back to an original physical system like a Landau-Stewart oscillator, or if you go back to a generic system, physical system that has a limit cycle oscillator that is done in the book by Pikowski and Kurz, the process that led you to a limit cycle usually implies that there is attractiveness in the perpendicular direction of the cycle, so there is always dissipation. Now the issue of no linearity or linearity, well, I mean, yeah, most oscillators are no linear in classical systems, but you can always couple linear oscillators in a classical system. I mean, couple two harmonic oscillators. And then the normal modes will determine what is the behavior of the couple system. So I would say that is not that it is what I would agree with Emilio, it is and that you might be focusing in different aspects in these quantum systems, but the mechanisms, I would say that they are not, say, no linearity versus dissipation, and one is predominated. Probably everything is present in both cases, it's just that you focus on a different context in one case and the other. Just that comment. So.
In the chat, you have a link by Gabor to the Wikipedia when they relate the Kuramoto model to Hamiltonian systems.
Yeah. Once you get to the Kuramoto model, you can relate to the Hamiltonian system. But if you take a physical system and want to obtain the Kuramoto model, I doubt that without dissipation you can do that.
I don't know.
That's my
I agree with Pera.
You have to have a limit cycle, a stable limit cycle behavior. And stability implies dissipation. And limit cycle implies forcing. And the balance between energy brought to the system and dissipation taken out of the system produce a limit cycle. That's the only mechanism or the typical mechanism that leads to that. That could be a Van der Pol, could be whatever. And then you can map that to, and when once you have the Kuramoto oscillator, which is just on the angle, then you can play around with those math. But from a physical system to get there, my feeling is that you need dissipation. This is getting very long. Sorry, I'm getting a bit off topic. Sorry.
Well, I see more things in the chat. I was just checking the Wikipedia, and I mean, you might have to correct it, but it says that the dissipative Kuramoto model is containing certain conservative Hamiltonian systems. They write the Hamiltonian and they derive Kuramoto model there. I don't know. I mean, there are people there that know much more than I do about the Kuramoto model. What is the chairman?
Okay. Well, I cannot see the chat, but if there are no...
Sorry, if the chairman is me, which I'm not sure, I'm here.
Okay.
I was looking, there are some more comments on the chat, but I don't know, should we go on with the discussion or...
I think we can finish.
Or we can finish here. Okay, so let's finish here. Thank you very much, Albert, and thank you everybody.
And thank you for
thank you everybody. Bye.
Thank you.
And thank you for your comments and attention. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.